faith of our Father's holy faith, we will be true to thee till death. Greetings, brothers and sisters. The Methodist Church St. Lucia Circuit extends a hearty welcome to all of you joining us for worship this Lord's Day. We are happy that you have chosen to join us and pray that this worship experience will be a blessing to you. We extend a happy and blessed Father's Day to all the men of the circuit and to all men joining us in worship this morning. May God bless you all immeasurably. Congratulations goes out to all those celebrating this week, be it a birthday, an anniversary, or any other special occasion this week. May God's glory shine bright in your life. If you are grieving the loss of a loved one, we extend our sincere condolences and pray that the faithful Lord, our God, bless and comfort you during this time. If you are going through a difficult period, we extend our love and prayers to you and pray God's comforting hands enfold you. We are encouraged to remain committed to our financial support of God's work through the Church. Your tithes, offerings, and donations can be deposited to the Republic Bank St. Lucia. Account number 950-1000-59919. We thank you for your generous giving. Today, our preacher is Rev'd Nuku. We bless God for him and look forward to the word which God has laid on his heart. Again, thank you for joining us today for worship.
Good morning, my brothers and sisters, and welcome to this morning's service. We are happy to be bringing this service into your homes this morning, and we trust that the service will be of a blessing to you all. Let me indicate to you that today is indeed Father's Day, and let me lend my voice in wishing all fathers a blessed day. Today, our preacher is going to be Rev'd Nuku. Let us go to our call to worship, and we can read or follow responsively as it is shown on the screen. Our relationships with our fathers are complicated. For some of us, our father's love is like God's love. Too deep, too long, too wide, too strong to measure. Some of our dads are here. Some were never here. For some of us, God's love fills in the empty spaces our fathers left behind. All of us are shaped by the relationship or lack of relationship with our fathers. On this day, when we remember what it means to have a father or to be a father, we recognize the importance of fathers in our communities. We pledge as a congregation to love and nurture the fathers among us so that they will manifest the love of God in all that they do. Let us continue our service this morning with our opening prayer, and we can all recite it together. Blessed are you, Lord, our God, creator and redeemer of all. You are our Father from all eternity, giving life and love to your good creation. In you alone we live and move and have our being. You have revealed yourself to us as our Father, and you have given us the right to become your children through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Today we come to worship you as you desire, in spirit and truth. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Let us sing our opening hymn this morning, and it is taken from the VIP number 384. O God, our Father, who dost make us one. I will now call upon Reverend Smith to do our prayers of adoration, confession, and thanksgiving.
Invite us to come to God in prayer. Let us pray. God, our Father, we come before you as we humble ourselves, but also as we adore you for who you are. You are from everlasting to everlasting. You in your faithfulness has remained steadfast throughout time and all seasons. Through all changing seasons, you have remained committed in your faithfulness, in your love for all humanity. We worship you in this Lord's Father's Day, knowing and acknowledge your supreme sovereign above all, also the source of life, also, O God, the commitment that you have for humanity, even as the psalmist asks, who is man that you care for, who Who is man that you are in search of and continue to sustain? We pray, O God, at this time, giving thanks to who you are and what you are in our lives. Indeed, as your Son Jesus Christ came into the world, teaching his disciples how to pray, reminding the disciples the intimate relationship he had with you, and also the expectation there is for all Christian, he opens the prayer, "Our Father, who art in heaven." We praise and honor you, O God. Even at times our Heavenly Father and Mother may abandon us, neglect us, we know, O God, that you will continue to be there for us no matter what. We worship you this morning. Even in your faithfulness, even in your protection, even as we find ourselves secure in you and our dwelling place for all generation, we confess that we have failed. We have failed in the fatherhood and role that each of us must play in our families, in our communities. We pray of the failure of the church in empowering men with the responsibility that you have called each to the role of being a father at home, the community, in church, and also at the various levels of our society. We pray, O God, that at times we have encouraged ways of life that is contrary to your word and to the way which you expect each and every one of us must live up to. Dear God, forgive us. Forgive us. Have mercy upon us. We pray that you will continue to empower us as a community to love you more and nurture men, women, and people within our community to know of the different roles and responsibilities that you expect of us, that we may live out our faith and continue to glorify your name. We pray in thanksgiving that even as we fail, your love never fails us. Even as we are unfaithful, you are always faithful. Even when our love for you sway, conditional, we know of your unconditional love and grace that is always there to carry us through life. And for that, we give you thanks. We give you thanks, O God, for the faithfulness of those whom you have called to be our fathers in our family this morning. We thank you for those who have gone before us. We thank you, O God, for those who continue to hold on to the fort of the role, even as some of our mothers, single mothers who have to play both roles in the life of our children. We thank you for our teachers in our schools, who can be role models to us, or has been role model to us, and some who continue to be role model to us and mentor, a reflection of your fatherhood into the lives of many that impress your way of life and your instruction. We give you thanks for life today. This is the prayer of adoration, confession, and thanksgiving, offered in no other name but in the mighty name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. At this time, we have a children's time, and I would like to share with us the word steadfastness. And the story that I draw to us is taken from Daniel chapter 3, verse 16 to 18, especially the story in which there was a stater in which King Nebuchadnezzar erected in the kingdom of Babylon, in which There was a time in which there was a sound on trumpet, and everyone was expected to bow down and worship. Verse 16 to 18 of Daniel chapter 3, it records that there were three people who defied the pressure, the influence of the king and all the courtier in the palace, and they said that they will continue to worship God and God alone. They were steadfast in their faith. They were steadfast in their commitment. They were steadfast that they would worship God and God alone. That story, to you, our children who are listening, reminds us of our commitment and holding firm to what is good, and especially what we believe that God wants of us in our life and in the school. I know we are drawing closer to the end of an academic year. Some of us has completed some of our exams. And we could be pressured into doing things that are contrary to the school rule, and also some of the things that may cause us to misbehave in school and at home. The first lesson that I want us, that we continue to be steadfast in holding so dearly the way in which God wants us to live our life, and to continue to do good, continue to live up to what is expected of us, and hold firmly. And also, we always, as we go nearer to the end of an academic term, sometimes laxity comes into us. We seems, oh, we have finished exams. We no longer thinking about things that is expected of us. But I remind us that school life is more than exams. That what you may do today may affect your future and tomorrow. So continue to hold fast, you, our children, to what is good, to what is right. Hold fast to what you have learned in your classroom, and also be able to go and live what you have learned at home. Sometimes we are totally different person in school and totally different person at home. So the message for us today, steadfast. And the story of the three persons in the book of Daniel reminds us, even they were willing to die for their faith and their steadfastness to their faith in God. This is my prayer to you, our children. Commit yourself, hold to what is good, and hold dear to the faith in Jesus Christ, a steadfastness no matter what. Let us pray. Almighty God, impress in the life of our children as they reflect the three persons in the book of Daniel, chapter 3, who, despite the pressure, were able to hold on to the faith. Our children are surrounded in peer pressure that they would want to have a sense of belonging with some of their friends, some within the community that they want to fit into. But as they try to fit into, they are influenced to do things that are contrary to your word. Pray that you will strengthen them to be steadfast in what is good, what glorifies your name. Bless them, O God, as they draw near to the end of an academic year, that they will be steadfast in your teaching, love for you, and the things that glorify your name. We pray this prayer in and through the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.
Thank you, Rev, for your prayers and your words to our children. We continue this morning's worship by singing hymn 397 in the VIP, "For the Might of Thine Arm We Bless Thee."
For the might of thine arm we bless thee, O God. hast kept thy pilgrim people by the strength of thy staff and rod. Thou hast called us to the journey which faithless feet ne'er trod. For the might of thine arm we bless thee, our God, our Father's God. For the love of Christ constraining that bound their hearts as one. For the faith in truth and freedom in which their work was done. For the peace of God's evangel, wherewith their feet were shod. For the might of thine arm we bless thee, our God, our Father's God. We are watchers of a beacon whose light must never die. We are guardians of an altar that shows the ever nigh. We are children of thy freemen who sleep beneath the sword. For the might of thine arm we bless thee, our God, our Father's God. May the shadow of thy presence around our camp be spread. Baptize us with the courage thou gave us to our dead. Oh, keep us in the pathway their saintly feet have trod. For the might of thine arm we bless thee, our God, our Father's God.
Let us go into the ministry of the word. And we will all recite together the collect as shown on your screen. God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for our fathers and all the love and support they offer. We ask for your blessing on them this Father's Day. Keep them in your care, support and guide them each day, and help them to grow in love and wisdom and knowledge of you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our first reading this morning is taken from Genesis chapter 22, verses 1 to 14. Genesis chapter 22, verses 1 to 14. After these things, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham," and he said, "Here I am." He said, "Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offerings and set out and went to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you." Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father, Father, he said, here I am, my son. The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Abraham said, God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. So the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here I am. He said, do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in the thicket by its horns. Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, the Lord will provide. As it is said to this day, on the mount of the Lord it shall be provided. Brothers and sisters, the word of the Lord. Our second reading this morning is taken from 1 John chapter 2, and we will be reading from verse 7 to 8 and 12 to 17. 1 John chapter 2, verses 7 to 8 and 12 to 17.
The word states, behold, I am writing you no new commandment, but an old commandment that you had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word that you have heard. Yes, I am writing you a new commandment that is true in him and in you. Because the darkness is passing away and the true light is already shining. Verse 12 to verse 17, it reads, I am writing to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven on the account of his name. I'm writing to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I am writing to you, young people, because you have conquered the evil one. I write to you, children, because you know the Father. I write to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young people, because you are strong and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the evil one. Do not love the world or the things in the world. The love of the Father is not in those who love the world. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eye, the pride in riches, come not from the Father, but from the world. And the world and its desires are passing away, but those who do the will of God live forever. The word of the Lord. This time we will sing hymn number 22, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassion. passions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above. Join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faith. Faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin, and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father.
Our gospel reading comes to us from Luke chapter 9, verse 14 to 29. Glory to you, O Lord. For there were about 5,000 men, and he said to his disciple, make them sit down in the groups about 50 each. They did so and made them all sit down. And taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke it, and broke them and gave it to the disciple to set before the crowd. And all ate and were filled. What was left over was gathered up, 12 baskets of broken pieces. Once when Jesus was praying alone with only the disciples near him, He asked them, "Who do the crowd say I am?" They answered, "John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others that one of the ancient prophets has arisen." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered, "The Messiah of God." He sternly ordered and commanded them not to tell anyone, saying, "The Son of Man must undergo great suffering, and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day he may be raised." Then he said to them, "If any want to become my follower, let them deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will save it. What does it profit them if they gain the whole world but lose or forfeit themselves? Those who are ashamed of me and of my word, of them the Son of God will be ashamed when he comes in his glory and the glory of the Father and the holy angels. But truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God." Now, about 8 days after this, saying Jesus took with him Peter, John, and James, and went up the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became dazzling white. The Gospel of Christ. Praise be to Christ our Lord. I invite us now to come to God in prayer as we reflect on God's word. Let us pray. Gracious and everlasting God, thank you for your word. Thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit that brings understanding and wisdom. Reveal to us the knowledge of you. Reveal to us the knowledge of who we are in you. Reveal to us the knowledge of who we can become as we journey with you in faith. We pray of our fathers who are listening, and also for those in our community joining from various parts of the world, and also in our community family here in St. Lucia, that we may make a difference because we receive and live out our faith in the light of your word. May the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable to you, O Lord, our great Redeemer. Pray in and through the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Today, I invite us to reflect on the Word of God as in our Old Testament reading, centering on the story of Abraham, on the theme, the faithful father. Today is Father's Day, and it is right that we should stop and honor our fathers. It is important that we take time to speak on the significance of fatherhood, not only on special occasions like today, but as a matter in the course of our life, as the role of father has been challenged and to some extent may be destroyed in the world that we now live in. Our society may be in a mode of attacking the role of fathers with such devastating force that sociologists now believe that we have sent the next generation to disastrous consequences because of this devaluation of the role of father in family and our community. Word of God today reflects on the story of Abraham, who through the salvation history of God, in God's pursuit and effort to bring about his purpose in the world and bring about salvation to all mankind, decided to choose one man. It was like putting all egg in a basket and trusting that his role as a father within the context of a family, that out of him blessing may overflow into his earthly family, and also he would be a blessing to a nation, to the all nations. So here is the faithful father, which gives us an example that as we are called and as we play the role God intends of us, that we can also make a difference in our community, and especially in the role, each role that God calls us to play in life. For those who are head of family, men in fatherhood, women in motherhood, and children, and also as we continue to develop for the future, that our young men and women will also know their places and what role they play. And drawn is this faithful father image that stand before us in our text today that we can learn from. Our text reminds us in verse 1 that after so many things that have happened to Abraham, and in fact so many testings that has happened in his life, verse 1 of Genesis chapter 22 says, after these things God tested Abraham. And as the story and narrative unfolds, there is a word that it catches our attention as we read through this scripture, which describes the faithfulness of Abraham as a father, and as God, through the faithfulness that Abraham displayed, was able to affirm his promise and blessing in the life of Abraham, that he was able to become the father of many nations. And it speaks to us here and now, and it draws us to this life of being faithful and trusting God no matter what we face, that can be affirmed to us that we can be the place, the being in which the promises of God are fulfilled in our lives, that will be beneficial to those whom are placed in our care and also in our community. This word that I draw to our attention comes to us in verse 1, verse 7, and verse 11. As Abraham responded, he says, "Here I am." When God was speaking to Abraham, calling Abraham, Abraham's response was, "Here I am." In verse 7, as Isaac the son had this conversation with Abraham and asked and called out to Abraham, again, Abraham responded, "Here I am." And in verse 11, again, as God spoke to Abraham, his response, "Here I am." And this word, "Here I am," draws to us this faithfulness, this availability of Abraham in two aspects that I call upon us to learn and be instructed in light of God's word. As Abraham was tested, we are tested every time as God calls us each day. Can we be the person who say, "Here I am"? 2 points highlighted from Abraham's response as God tested him to evaluate, to see his performance, that his faith is not only a faith of word, but of action, that he was able to display the genuineness of his trusting God and his availability to God. But first, which reminds us of the faithful father, that Abraham was a father who was always available to God. This is important because as God called him, he said, "Here I am." The Hebrew word that denotes this English translation, "Here I am," is taken in three meanings. One, it is his attentiveness. Second is his readiness. Third is his willingness. So even before the instruction was given for him to sacrifice his only son, the son whom he loved, the son whom he cared for, Abraham has this attentiveness, readiness, and willingness that he availed himself to God. This is important for us here and now, brothers and sisters in Christ. As we live our life, living out our faith in the world is not an easy endeavor. Like Abraham, we each day are called by God to live out our faith. And the question is, do we have this attentiveness to God to see that everything in the midst of busyness of the world, can we attend to God's call in our life? Are we ready and prepared to do whatever it means for us to avail ourselves to God? Do we have this willingness? The example that Abraham has set before us is a lot that is happening in communities, in society, in the life of the church. What is at stake can only be addressed if we have the Abraham of our community who avail themselves to God, as our scripture reading says today, that when God tested him, he just said, "Here I am, God. Here I am, God." Today, the absence of men and fathers in our churches is a crisis. The absence of men and fathers in levels of our community is something that we must think through in our lives. But foremost, in a life of faith. Because a father that is grounded in faith, a father that is available to God, a father that is God-fearing, is one that makes a difference, not only in their lives, but in the life of family, especially in the life of their children. James chapter 1, verse 2 to 4 reminds us, as James says, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete and lacking in nothing." Yes, it is not easy to live out our faith. But as we make ourselves available to God each day, in the testing, in the afflictions of life, we can mature in our faith journey as we avail ourselves to God, that the promise of God may be fulfilled in our lives. Faith is matured through the experience of stressful testing in much the same way that our cardiovascular system is strengthened through exercise and muscles are developed through exercise. James continues and makes a major contribution to our understanding when using the Moriah incident as an example. He explains, "Faith by itself, if it does not have work, is dead." James 2:17. The story of Abraham reminds us the stretching of Abraham's faith through what was required of him to live out his faith by trusting God, even in a very difficult situation. He continued to avail himself to God, no matter what. Faith is not lived out in a vacuum. It operates in the tension of life and also demonstrates itself more fully by its response to the furnace and afflictions, and not only in the shallow water of ease and prosperity. For faith to become visible, it has to perform. As James says, show me your faith without your work, and I will show you my faith by my work. And for the story of Abraham in Genesis 22, God set the stage in which Abraham, through the affliction and turmoil of his life, that he remained available to God, no matter the contradiction that was set before him. He continued to say, I am going to be obedient to God no matter what, but I know who God is and what he would provide. And as I am faithful to him, as I make myself available to him despite and in spite of all, at the end, as if you read through the story, Abraham was able to receive this word from the Lord. I know now that you, Abraham, have fear for God. And all of that was only possible, brothers and sisters in Christ, because from the very beginning, Abraham continued to avail himself to God. We are called now, whatever the situation in your family, whatever the situation in our community, whatever the situation in our churches, it may be failing, it may be struggling, it may be facing afflictions. What makes the difference, brothers and sisters in Christ, are fathers, mothers, Christians who continue to avail themselves to God no matter what, and in and through them, God can establish his promise and bring about blessing that make a difference in lives individually and communally. A second point that I draw to our attention today is not only how Abraham availed himself to God, but also to his own son, Isaac. And it is important that the faithful father, Abraham, was one who availed himself to his son, Isaac. In verse 7 of Genesis 22, it reads, Isaac said to his father, Abraham, Father, and this is what, again, the same word that Abraham offered to God, here I am. Abraham said to his son, here I am, my son. This is important. A father who was tested for his faith, who was going now to sacrifice his own son on the altar, had this time for his son and say, here I am, son. In a study in the United States by the National Center for Fathers, it highlights that more than 20 million children live in a home without the physical presence of a father. Millions more have fathers that are present physically but absent emotionally. They don't have any connection with their children. Studies also show that children without fathers are more likely to become involved in drugs, abuse, involved in drugs and alcohol abuse, drop out of school, and suffer from health and emotional problems. Fathers are meant to provide strength and support for their family. So when a father figure is non-existent, children and teenagers are affected. We don't have to look far to see the absence of fathers in our family, the neglect of fatherly roles in our family, and also in our churches and community as a whole. Paul draws to attention of Christian children and also highlights the responsibility of father in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1 to 4, when he says to the Christian children, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and your mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may be well with you and you may live long on earth. And fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. One of the greatest needs now in our community to heal the life of our children that have crossed our children to a life of anger. Angry children that have grown up to be angry youths, that have grown up to be angry adults, because fathers have provoked them to anger by being absent and not surrounding them with the love that they are supposed to experience. As Abraham attended to Isaac, "Here I am, my son." And in fact, the text reminds us that Abraham loved Isaac. How the text in Genesis describes this relationship between Abraham and Isaac. It says in three levels, he was Abraham's son, he was Abraham's only son, and he was Abraham's only son that he loved. This shows this close relationship. Many of our children are provoked to anger because absent in their lives is a fatherly figure that loves them, and also a figure that is supposed to bring them up in discipline and instruction in the Lord. How can we do that when fathers themselves are absent in the Lord? If we are not going to teach children to work, they are going to learn to steal. If we are not going to teach children to love, they are going to learn to destroy and break lives and families and family to the extent that they can murder. Our community today are festered with so many social ills that go back to children who are angry, provoked to anger by absentees of father. Dad, if you don't teach your children how to work, the world will teach them how to steal. If you don't teach your sons how to love and respect, they will learn how to disobey and dishonor. If you don't teach your children honesty, the world will teach them to cheat. This is important for us as we are called to be the father who is faithful. Today, as we honor fatherhood, I call on us individually and communally to honor the role and the importance of father and ensure that we encourage one another to the point that we would be like this faithful father of Abraham, who availed himself to God and availed himself to his son. And at the end of the story, the biblical narrative says that God, through the angel, appeared and told Abraham, "I am going to bless you. I'm going to affirm to you the promise." Paul also draws to our attention that honoring our father and mother is a commandment with a promise, a commandment with a blessing. As we search out blessing, as we search out prosperity, as we search out success in our community today, laid within a life that can make a difference is a faithful father, a faithful Christian who avails himself to God and avails himself surrounding their children with love. And it is my prayer today, we as a church, as a community of believers, continue to stretch out, continue to commit ourselves to ensure that our fathers avail themselves to God and avail themselves to our children to bring about a life of discipline, instruction in the Lord, and a loving community that our children can learn the faith, can live the faith, and also grow the faith no matter what. This is my prayer, that we may be the Abraham of today, that in us would be fulfilled a new generation of our children who would avail themselves to God and who also will commit themselves to a loving relationship with their children that will form a blessing in this land. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, let us come to God in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, the faithful, the one whom called Abraham, the one who developed and nurtured Abraham's faith, the one who blessed Abraham to be father of nations. We pray, as we articulate, reflect on your word, and as your word sinks into our lives, if there are men out there, fathers, who have neglected their responsibility, who have not been availing themselves to you, O God, through their faith life, through relationship with you, we pray that they may commit themselves anew to you today. We pray of the structures of the church and society. And pray, O God, that there may be a time in which we have a systematic way of destroying, of dishonoring our father and fatherhood. We pray that there may be healing, there may be restoration, there may be reconciliation in families, children and fathers, fathers and mothers, that will enable, O God, a continuous availability before you as they attend, as they are ready and they are willing to go alongside you in this journey to develop their faith in you and trust in you. We pray also, O God, in the policies that are made at national level, communal level, and also in spiritual levels, that we must ensure at a time in which fatherhood may be in crisis, that we can be the Abraham of now, that in us may be fulfilled the promise to be fathers of nations. We pray this blessing. This we pray and ask in and through the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. A hymn of Respond, hymn 318, O God, what offering shall I give to thee?
To thee, O Lord.
Now continue the spirit of worship as we offer prayers of intercession in the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. God, our Heavenly Father, we come before you, availing ourselves as we intercede for others. We pray for the father and mother of our nations, those whom you have called to lead us in this time and in this season. Endow them with the counsel and wisdom and understanding that comes from you. And we pray, O God, that they will avail themselves to you, even if it seems that your command to them is contradiction, that even as they struggle through their choices and decision-making, that they, O God, will continue to avail themselves and trust you no matter what. We pray, O God, of the spirit of revelation, that you will continue to reveal to them who you are, your purpose and your will, in the time that you have allocated for them to lead us, that justice may reign and rule and be the foundation. They will live a life and govern with impartiality and with love and care. And pray, O God, that they won't provoke anger on the children of our beautiful nation of St. Lucia, but surround us with love and care and discipline and instruction in the way, O God. We pray of our spiritual leaders. We pray, O God, that you will give them the vision, the spiritual insights. Those who are our father, our mother, our parents spiritually, our mentor, may they be a good example to us in the faith. May their faith be a tested faith, a genuine faith, a faith that has withstood time, has withstood affliction, suffering, a faith that has endured, a faith that has been brought alive through the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray that you will endow them with their fatherly role. Continue, O God, to live their lives as you have expected of them. We bring the life of our children and our youth at this time. We bring to you young men, those who are on our streets, those who may now be angered, provoked to anger by so many things that they lived through in their childhood, in their youths. We pray that healing may come before them. And we pray, O God, that they may be exposed to the love, even if they have missed that love from home, that there may be an opportunity that they may experience your love anew in their lives that can heal them and help them, O God, to be disciplined in life and instructed in your way. Give them a godly conscience. We pray, O God, for the many crimes that are happening around us. And we pray that you will influence their lives and bring, O God, our communities to be able to be faithful in our availability to you and to each other, to provide the love that will be catalyst to change and blessing, and fulfilled is your promises for us individually and as a community. We pray of the Castries Methodist Church, Forestier Methodist Church, Gosselet, and Hughes Castle Brown. It will be a church and community in the St. Lucia Methodist Circuit, the South Caribbean District, and the MCCA as a whole. I celebrate today Father's Day. It will be a church who avail ourselves to you, live by the example and faith and life that Abraham himself has displayed to us today. And we will live our lives to be Father of nations, people who would see the light and glorify you. This is the prayer of intercession. We pray in and through the name of Jesus, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven. O Lord, be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As we draw our service to conclusion, this is my prayer, this time and in this season, that we will continue to avail ourselves and discern as God leads us as our Heavenly Father. And it will influence our young men in a broken society, desolated of fathers, in need of fatherhood and fatherly figures in our family, in our community, that we could be the Abraham who avail ourselves to God and avail ourselves to our children, that will bring about discipline and instruction in life, and also the love that so much of us very much need here and now. With so many things happening around us, what they need is a faithful father, committed, availing oneself to God and availing oneself to them. Now we will sing hymn 331, Lead Us, Heavenly Father, Lead Us. Receive the benediction. Listen to what the Lord says. I have loved you with an everlasting love, and still I maintain my unfailing love towards you. I will lead you beside quiet streams and down smooth, uncluttered path, so that you do not stumble. For I have become a father to you, and you are my firstborn child. My God, our glorious Father, open the eyes of our hearts so that you might see the hope to which He is calling you, the riches of the inheritance He has prepared for you, and the power that is at work among you. Go in the grace of God. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of us, now and forevermore. Amen.